The note said, "Darling, I hate to tell you this way, but I've run off with your roommate. Signed, your fiancé." I sat down and cried. What else could I do? That's when I noticed that my car keys were missing, too. And so was my favorite sweater, and my TV, and my stereo. My whole life crumbled before my eyes. Where was I to go? I ran to the supermarket in a blinding rage, craving foods I have not touched since I was 12 years of age. 'Cause not only did my man run out today, my boss let me go. I have been depressed before, but never quite this low. Yes, I guess I've been depressed, but ever this low, no. And I ran up and down the aisles of the supermarket, crying and shaking and pulling things off the shelves based solely on their carbohydrate, calorie, and cholesterol count. I didn't go overboard, just enough to get me through the night. So I threw my purchases down on the conveyor belt. They rolled up to the checkout girl. She looked at them, she looked at me, and she said, "Hey lady, can't you read? The sign here says express. I'll check you out if you have got 10 items or less. But you've got 2, 4, 6, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 things right here. If you want me to check you through, put 3 things back, my dear." "Well, no," I said defiantly, trying not to shake. But she said, "Sweetheart, you don't need those Hostess Twinkies. You don't need that coffee cake. And why those famous Amos cookies? Let me tell you, they are grossly overpriced. Put 3 things back. Those are the rules. I'm asking you real nice." But I just couldn't. So she said, "Okay, well then, put back those frozen pizzas or that box of pudding on a stick. Why, just looking at all these calories makes my stomach want to flip." But I refused to back down. She refused to check me through. The line behind me was growing longer and angrier too. The line behind me was growing longer. There was pushing and shoving and cursing and swearing too. "Look, I'm not trying to make trouble," I said to her, "but I'm having the worst kind of day. You see, today I lost my job, my car, my TV, my stereo, my favorite sweater, my roommate, not to mention my fiancé." But she shook her head and shouted, "3 things have got to go. Those are the rules. Oh, please, please, please," I begged. She bellowed, "No. Please, 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 please," I begged. But she said, "No." And she was enjoying the power trip of it all. Because then all the other cashiers in solidarity shut down. The sudden empty silence was an eerie, spooky sound. Then all the customers started screaming, especially those with frozen foods. The manager came running, he was in an ugly mood. Yes, the manager, he came running, he was ugly, so was his mood. Well, now I tried explaining to him my situation about my job, my fiancé, and my car, but he didn't give me half a chance. He just said, "Who the hell do you think you are? My whole store is paralyzed all on account of you. Now Manhattan is going hungry 'cause you won't follow rules. Yes, Manhattan is gonna starve tonight 'cause of stupid, selfish, solipsistic you." I didn't know what that meant either. I didn't know why he was using such a big word on me, but it was because he really hated his job as store manager. He would just sit in the back room every day, reading the dictionary and then taking the "It Pays to Increase Your Word Power" test in Reader's Digest magazine. This has nothing to do with the song, but since it's a play, I did a little character development. Well, I know by now I must have looked real pitiful. Tears were streaming down my face. He was not moved. He did not think that mine was a special case. So he grabbed me and he dragged me as I was sobbing toward the door when a soft voice whispered, "I've got 7 items. I'll take 3 of yours." Well, I turned and I looked at the handsomest man I've ever seen. Golden hair, tweed suit, a bow tie, eyes the bluest green. Well, the checkout girl was furious, but what else could she do? She checked both our items, and he said, "Let me carry them for you." Yeah, she checked all of our items, and he even paid for mine, too. He did, and he carried them up to my apartment, and he put them down on my table. Well, he
put them down on the ironing board that I use as my table. And he looked around my apartment and he said, "You look like the kind of woman who shouldn't be having dinner by herself tonight." Which I think was his way of saying, "You look like you can't cook." But I let that go by. And he said, "Please, allow me to take you out for dinner tonight. I would like to take you out to the Quilted Giraffe." And I thought to myself, the Quilted Giraffe? That's the most expensive restaurant in New York City. Why would he want to take me there? So I said to him, "Why are you being so nice to me? I don't even know you. I'm having such a terrible day." And he said, "Well, I've got to do something to cheer myself up. You see, today I lost my job, and when I came home from work, I found a note stuck to my refrigerator from my fiancée, and she had run off with somebody else." I said, "Are you kidding? The same thing happened to me." And he said, "Yes, I'm kidding." I am so gullible, it makes me so mad sometimes. But he did make me laugh, so I thought, okay, I'll go out and have dinner with him. I'll eat that food I can't pronounce. I'll drink that expensive wine. It was an incredible meal. It was the kind of meal you read about in Cosmopolitan magazine. And it totally, totally changed my life, though. Some things are still the same. I still do my grocery shopping in that same grocery store. But you won't find me standing in the express line anymore. 'Cause I no longer shop for one. I shop for two, you see. And today my doctor tells me I'm shopping for three. Yesterday I get the good word. I'm shopping for three. Now, technically the song could be over here, but there's a couple of loose ends, and since this is a play, I've written another act. Well, my roommate and my fiancé, remember them? They stole my car. Well, my car broke down that night. In a blinding thunderstorm, they hitchhiked back and they had a terrible fight. They did not see that 68 Chevy come speeding around the curve. And who was that behind the wheel? That nasty checkout girl. I know you're thinking, what an unbelievable coincidence. But guess who was sitting next to her? Her fiancé, the store manager. And what were they doing? They were having a terrible fight. It was like an epidemic that night. You see, he was furious with her because she wouldn't check through the woman with the 13 items and paralyze the store. And she was so mad at him because he let the guy with the bow tie pay for the 13 items and they both got out of the store and escaped. She thought they should have been arrested and then executed in front of a firing squad. And when he didn't agree, she knew that they were incompatible and she was just inconsolable. And she was going to drive her car right into those two strangers, which happened to be my roommate and my fiancé, standing in the blinding thunderstorm, and all four of them were going to die in a fiery wreck. She was going to drive the Chevy off the levee, but the levee was wet. In truth, that's how I would have ended the song in my younger, more unsophisticated days, but it's time for a kinder, a gentler ending. Oh, the checkout girl slammed on the brakes, stopped in time. She offered them a ride. My fiancé fell in love with her. The store manager made my roommate his bride. And now she works stocking kitty litter in the cat food aisle. When I see her on my shopping sprees, I flash my sweetest smile. Hi, yeah, the Quilted Giraffe again last night. Oh, the moral of the story is one can never tell. What could be in store for you on your local grocery shelf? And sometimes you've got to break the rules if someone breaks your heart. And if you're lucky, love might fall into your shopping cart.